There's nothing more New England than a country fair in autumn. Sadly, most of them are gone. But the Freiburg Fair, the granddaddy of them all, has been going strong since 1851. What makes it so special? Well, as one old-timer put it, it ain't never changed.
In her 25 years on Chronicle, Mary has traveled countless main streets and back roads of New England. But she's also traveled the world, from Asia to Africa, Europe, Mexico, Alaska, and the Caribbean, exploring communist countries, ancient cultures, and the land of her heritage, Ireland.
Well, Ireland was great. Ireland was great. Just the way of life there is so different, and the pace of life, and the language, the poetry of their language, and the beauty of the countryside. It's a country that's really been discovered by the rest of the world, and so gorgeous.
The most memorable?
It has to be China, because it was the longest trip for one. It was 3 weeks in China on the ground. It was so overwhelming. When I called home, everybody said, so what's it like? And the first thing I said, there are a lot of people there. In those days, they didn't have many cars. So you'd be walking down a street and the red light would change and 1,000 bicycles would come at you. You'd never seen anything like it in your life.
Rush hour, a sea of bicycles, a hub of activity. This is Canton.
The people were so gracious.
What does your family want to buy first, and then second, and then third?
The first is the washing machine.
We interviewed some experts in China, and they said, in China, you can never put the genie back in the bottle. Now people have experienced forms of capitalism, the country's opening up, and so on. And of course, just a few years later came Tiananmen Square and the great crackdown. Somebody once said to me that Chronicle is more of a vocation than it is a job, and there's some truth to that, because your outside life, your private life, also intersects with your working life. In this case, a Jesuit priest, a friend of mine, Father Bill Berry, told me about a young man in prison.
And I mentioned how the kind of things he was doing for the community, as well as the fact that he had lost his own son to gang violence and was trying to do something to stop it.
Daryl Jones was sent to prison at 19 for a fatal Brockton shooting. Jones is a lifer. The motivation, he says, for working so hard to keep his own sons and other young men from embracing violence.
Bill Cosby lost his son. Michael Jordan lost his, you know, his father. You're looking at the situation with Jennifer Hudson. We don't got a gun problem. We got a culture problem.
And it took a lot for a lot of these guys to step up, to be men, to come up in here and say, wait a minute, this is not the real story.
So he got several of the inmates in prison to make a film about what it's really like to be incarcerated. It was too late for his own son. His own son was killed in an apparent gang shooting.
Unable to attend his son's funeral, Daryl asked Father Berry to bless the grave. In prison, Jones listened to the prayers by phone.
Oh, my son Absalom, my son Absalom. Would that I had died instead of you, O Absalom, my son.
Mary Richard is a person who cares, who's always willing to help the community. And you know, I think she gets embarrassed sometimes by getting some of these awards, because she's not one of those type of people. You know, in the media, there's a lot of folks with huge egos. She has no ego at all. She just loves her job, loves the people.
Over the years, Mary has quietly donated her time to many local charities. Just this year, she received the Lifetime Achievement Award from the Greater Boston Chamber of Commerce and was the first recipient of the Tim Russert Award from Boston Healthcare for the Homeless. Her involvement with that organization is how Mary heard the compelling story of Dennis Eckersley and his brother Wally, a story they would agree to share with Chronicle.
This is the story of two brothers. You know Dennis Eckersley, a Hall of Fame baseball pitcher whose electric fastball made him one of the all-time greats. But few know the sad story of his older brother Wally, whom Dennis idolized as a child. Wally Eckersley struck out in life, from homelessness to prison, where he spent the last 21 years for attempted murder.
essentially you were the driver in a crime that was not pretty, but you were the getaway driver.
I take full responsibility for all of that.
How did you do the kind of time you've done over 20 years?
You do this one day at a time.
For many years after Wally went to prison, he and Dennis spoke only sporadically. Dennis says he had to work through some unresolved anger toward his brother. But one day in 2001, Dennis's wife Jennifer said, it's time to reach out.
And that story has touched me very deeply because Wally ultimately was paroled, left prison, got a job, speaks all the time to college kids, high school kids.
Looking back, I wouldn't have shared it with anybody else. So I think that says a lot about Mary, you know, that she's so trusting. To have everything turn out the way that it did for my brother and for her to see it through. I've always admired her from afar. So it's nice to end up having a friendship, because she'll be a friend for life.